I once tried to recruit a congregant who was a professor of English to teach a very common adult education course among Unitarian Universalists called Building Your Own Theology. "Theology, John?" he said. "I teach poetry." "Ed," I said, "what's the difference?" As a mentor of mine put it, the spirit of high religion and poetry is the same. Imaginative compassion. "Oh, those are words of Thomas Hardy," he said. Indeed, they are. But in case you haven't noticed, religion, even more than poetry, is rather out of fashion these days. It wasn't always the case. Many of us grew up in the culture that was shaped just after World War II, when I was born. For in the generation thereafter, congregational life in America just blossomed and bloomed everywhere. Marianne Moore, by the way, first wrote her poem Poetry after World War I and then revised and republished it again after the Second World War. Such tragedies among human beings deepen the sense that we need to search for meaning and imaginative compassion and connection and pass on those insights to coming generations. By the early 1960s, church membership in America had reached a peak. People forgot that religion and poetry share deep roots and began to take it much too literally. Division set in over gender, generation, sexuality, ethnicity, nation, tradition. Liberals went left while conservatives went right, and in conservative areas of America, liberal religion grew only as a refuge against prevailing surrounding conservative culture. And conservatives fought back on the airwaves. Evangelists founded groups like the Moral Majority, which was never either. And politicians on the right co-opted fearful people of faith, paradoxically, around losing racial and cultural dominance, using wedge issues like prayer in the schools, homosexuality, abortion, and now it would seem critical race theory. God forbid that our nation should examine its conscience on race. So here we are, facing another Thanksgiving, gathered in non-creedal spiritual community, people of many different beliefs and backgrounds, including people who claim to have no beliefs. For when people are now asked, "What is your religion?" the fastest growing group in America is now those who reply, "None." Yet I want to question that response. Are there no meanings or rhythms or poems that you live by? Today, the ethnic group in America that's most likely to say none, interestingly, is Asian Americans. But I live in the most Asian American part of San Francisco, and I can tell you from observation and friendship with my neighbors, it's not true. They have shrines to their ancestors. They practice Tai Chi and meditation. They celebrate the autumn moon and the Lunar New Year and have other forms of practice, however infrequent. "I am spiritual but not religious," many say. And I get that. So I hope am I. My spirituality, my morning walking meditation, my journal keeping, my devotional reading, and my love of poetry may not be your practice. But in a community like this one, we take diversity in our personal practices for granted. We too dislike religion when it becomes divisive. And yet within it, after all, we find that there are things that are important beyond rituals and creeds. Hands in community that can help, souls that can grow, spirits that can rise and give praise for the gift of life, even in the face of difficult times and pandemics and attacks of despair. These things are important not because a high-sounding interpretation can be put upon them, but because they are useful or even essential. When religion becomes so derivative as to become unintelligible, then the same can be said for all of us, that we do not admire what we cannot understand. Spare us the arcane rituals and the theologians disputing liturgical practices while revolutions go on, or debating how many angels can fit on the head of a pin. I am a bit more sympathetic to the wild prophets and even to immovable cynics lifting a nose like an arrogant ass feeling a flea. And to some sectarian fans, or to ushers counting the attendance and the money. Nor do I think it is valid to discriminate against pledge cards and stories for all ages. All these phenomena are important, though one must make a distinction when dragged into prominence by the half-faithful, the result is not always religious. Nor until the truly courageous and faithful among us can be doers of the word and not hearers only. Beyond self-righteous posturing and piety, and can present for inspection some hint of the imagined beloved community right here on earth among toads like us. Shall we have it? But in the meantime, if you demand on the one hand the raw material of human spiritual life in all of its rawness, and what is on the other hand genuine, then you are interested in that form of spiritual connection that we attempt to build here in non-creedal religious community. Another American poet, William Carlos Williams, objected to Marianne Moore's poem. "There's no such thing as poetry," he said. "There are only poems." And similarly, philosopher John Dewey said that there's no such thing as religion. There are only particular religious people and communities. And I must also agree. Forget the abstractions or generalizations. Poetry, said Robert Frost, begins with a lump in the throat. Religion, too, it's wise to remember, begins with feeling. Call it the experience of finitude, an awe before the sun rising in the morning, a sense of the holy, of ultimate dependence on things not of our making. Surely it is older and wiser and more universal than any cult or creed. Our response to this experience of our smallness is written not in our big words or our aspirations. Take those yard signs, now popular. Science is real. Black lives matter. No human is illegal. Love is love. Women's rights are human rights. Kindness is everything. Lots of you have such signs. To them, I sometimes want to say, yeah, the words are fine. Now show me your date book, your checkbook, your emails, your volunteer hours or giving record, and I'll show you where what your religion truly is. Religion, wrote my mentor in ministry, Jacob Trapp, as right beliefs or right observances becomes divisive and absurd. But religion is walking with others in humility, being attentive to others, responding to them in responsibility, is not a creed, but a way of life. To be truly religious is every day to be grateful for the much we are given, and to respond by seeking to give in return as much as we can. Religion, then, is a way of life with responsiveness and compassion, reverence for sacred potential, respect for ourselves and for one another, for Mother Earth and all her creatures. A way of life renewed each day in blessing. that love of life beautifies, even to the very end. I sometimes wonder what a God's eye assessment of Americans' true religious commitments would look like these days. I'm sorry to say this, but I think that it might be you and I believe first and foremost in me, the full potential of me, in folks just like me, not them, people who voted another way, who were raised another way, who follow another creed. I'm reminded of an encounter that I had some years ago at this very season. It was in a shopping mall. People were scurrying around laden with presents and purchases, and I was meditating on how even giving to others in our materialistic society easily becomes a spiritual competition in ego over who is more generous. When I saw a teenage boy bopping down the corridor, carrying absolutely nothing but listening to the music coming through his earbuds and wearing a t-shirt with the memorable phrase, "Only you can prevent narcissism." Which brings me to a real question. Can you then be truly religious all by yourself? Going to the church of me? All too many these days, I think, seem to think so. But the wisest, the more humble, doubt that that is really possible. Because the spiritual dimension of life lies in the between dimension. The dimension of connection between our fellow human beings and ourselves, and between ourselves and all that is. It lies in the self-critical dimension. The very word religion, after all, comes from the Latin religio, meaning literally to relink, which may be why we are here again today and grateful to be reunited after being so physically separated, trying to relink ourselves spiritually and prepare for genuine Thanksgiving. We need not give up on bowing our heads in gratitude, you know, for the simple gift of being here, of being here together, in our diversity, our mutual respect, enjoying the fruits of the earth and resolving together to do our best to treat this fragile planet, this creation, and our fellow pilgrims with the reverence they deserve. That, by the way, wouldn't make a bad grace for this Thursday. Yet many in our world are finding it difficult to rejoin any form of community after so many months of pandemic isolation and broken habits. My compassion goes out to them, for they are languishing. Good word that my own pastor uses. Not quite in anguish, but also not really thriving. Feeling disconnected, yearning for more authentic connection, deeper joy and gratitude. Many seem wary or testy. You can see it in our politics, surely, in the lack of social trust and hope for the future. Many seem unwilling to be in any way happy again, or to rejoice in simply being in community. When so many have died, when we still here have survived. Then I think it is the oppressed who offer the most wisdom to those of us who are relatively privileged. The Palestinian American poet Naomi Shihab Nye writes, "It's difficult to know what to do with happiness. With sadness, there's something to rub against, a wound to attend with lotion and cloth. When the world falls in around you, you have pieces to pick up, something to hold in your hands like ticket stubs or change, but happiness floats. It doesn't need you to hold it down. It doesn't need anything, since there is no place large enough to contain so much happiness. You shrug, you raise your hands, and it flows out of you into everything you touch. You are not responsible. You take no credit, as the night sky takes no credit for the moon, but continues to hold it and share it, and in that way be known. We began this service by hearing the definition of religion given by philosopher Whitehead, the founder of what is now called process philosophy, in which no phenomenon is final because all is process, all is becoming, even religion. In scripture, it says that to everything there is a season, a time to mourn, a time to organize for what Jews call the repair of the world, tikkun ha'olam, guiding it towards sustainability, justice, and peace, and real shalom. Days when we have to come together in sorrow or righteous indignation, even anger, when we come to hold up one another's hands because they are faltering, and because we are community and bear one another's burdens. But today I invite you to come in the joy of knowing what we are when we are authentic. We are grateful. When we are grateful together, that is religion. And despite everything, and with some reservations about some of its expressions, we can almost like it again, because it helps us transcend our narcissism, get beyond me, try to become a better person, more considerate, more connected. And because without it, all we would have is a small little self and a person entirely tied up in his or herself, said one great preacher, makes a very small package. So let us pray and contemplate extending our imagination and our compassion and becoming more really religious. Amen.
Thank you so much. We will now take the offering. Love is the spirit of this church and service its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another.